Hello, everyone, and welcome to Central at Home. No matter where you're watching from or when you're watching this, we're just so glad you've decided to spend the next 45 minutes or so with us. If you've been impacted at all by these experiences that we've been having, we would love it if you took a second right now to share on whatever platform you're using right now to watch. We would love it if more people got to hear this life-transforming message and hear about our community of faith. Also, today we're going to be taking communion together. So if you want to take a second right now, go grab something to eat and something to drink, doesn't matter what it is, and come on back. We'll be doing that together later on. I want to thank you as well for your generous giving. Everything we do here, we do because of you and your partnership with us. We're able to reach people and introduce them to our faith community and our life-transforming message. If you'd like to partner with us in giving, you can do so by going to centralcc.ca/give and set up a one-time or ongoing partnership. There's two things we really hope for you from our experience today. First and most important is that you find a way to connect with God during this experience, whether that's engaging in the worship, it's journaling your thoughts and your prayers from this experience, it's going through the discussion questions with those in your household or some friends online, or connecting with the online host for some more ideas. We just really want you to be able to connect with God. The second thing that we hope for you is that you're able to connect with others during this experience and afterwards, especially in times like these. There's four different ways that you can do that. First, you can engage with Central at Home by talking in the chat window, even right now. You can also join a group. We have groups for every age and interest and so many different times. It won't be hard to find a group that fits for you. You can also join in on our prayer times. We just finished an amazing 21 days of prayer, and we're going to keep that momentum going in February and March by praying every Tuesday together from 6 to 7 a.m. starting this Tuesday, February 2nd. Lastly, if you're joining us live today, we actually have a virtual Connect event. So if you're new to Central, or if you've been around for the last year or so, maybe even haven't been able to join us in person yet, we would love it if you signed up for that and got to know some others. If you have any questions at all, you can head to centralcc.ca/connect or text the word central to 905-937-5610. That's all from me today, so get excited because our experience starts right now.
Hey, thanks for joining us today. I want to invite you to worship with us, to sing, to give God everything you got right there, right where you are. Join us.
Arise, my soul, remain.
For your glory,
oh, all of
God, we're aware that you are always working, God. We're aware, God, even right now, we want to trust you that you are working. Gonna do to get you through. That song is actually a song I wrote at the beginning of lockdown number one, and I feel like those words couldn't be more true, like even today. Mm-hmm. You know, nothing is wasted and God is in control. And that's something we want to pray about today around the theme of trust.
Yeah.
God is with us in our pain, in our frustration, in the storm, and we got to trust that He's in control. We got to trust that He is going to make all things beautiful in His right time, in His perfect time. And sometimes that's really hard to do. So I just want to encourage you as I pray right now to just give God control. Give God your frustration. Give God your pain. He's got you. Let's pray.
Good.
God, we want to put you in your rightful place right now. God, you are the one who created us all. You know what's going to happen next before we even know. You have planned our steps ahead of us. And so, God, we put our lives in your hands. And we ask, God, that you would take control. Because sometimes we feel like we don't have it, and especially right now. God, for those of us who might not even feel like they have the strength to trust you right now, would you give them that strength? Would you give them the ability to reach out to you and to call on you? Even you go ahead and do that for us. You give us the strength we need to connect with you and to trust you and rely on you. So God, that is our prayer today. We acknowledge that you're in control and we trust you. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to take a few moments today and we're going to celebrate communion together. And so if you haven't already, we want to encourage you to get something to eat, something to drink. It doesn't matter what they are. It's just important that you participate with us, and you're going to be participating with people all across our region, actually all across our nation and around the world. And so we're going to do this together. And so as always, when we participate in communion, I try to take a moment and I just read through the story, read through the Lord's Supper. And I was reading it even this past week in Luke chapter 22. And it just kind of struck me in a new light. I was reading it and you know what really kind of stood out to me was just the feelings that they would have had. And the first feeling I imagine that they had in that moment was just this feeling of uncertainty. I know it's almost a buzzword in our culture right now, but I felt it with them in that moment, that they would have felt like, as Jesus described to them, that this would be the last time that they ever ate together. That feeling of, well, what's going to happen? Yeah. We don't know. And then the other feeling I imagine that they had was this just feeling of unclear direction. Where are we going to go? What are we going to do? What's going to happen? Where should we turn? And then the third feeling I imagine they had was just a heaviness, a really heaviness, that this is just really hard. This isn't what we hoped for. This isn't what we wanted. And maybe you feel like that today. Maybe you feel some of those feelings of just uncertainty, unclear direction, heaviness. And so I was reading this story, and in the middle of it, it just popped out to me again. I don't know why it hit me. It just was this overwhelming feeling. And Jesus said, all of this that I did, all of this that I'm doing right now, I pour out my cup for you. I break my body. It's going to be broken for you. Yeah. And it was like in that moment, it just hit me how much God loves you and how much He loves me, that everything He ever did on this earth was for you. And wherever you're at today, I feel it in this moment. I feel overwhelmed by this truth that God's love is for you. He'd do anything for you. And then I thought, you know what? How should I respond to that? And my first thought was, my response should be that I pour out my love back on Him. You know, I pour out my love back on Him. I say, God, I trust you. I relinquish my control and I give it back to you. And so today, as we take communion, we're just declaring, we're speaking to our uncertainty. Yeah. We're saying, God, we trust you through it. We're speaking to our unclear direction. God, you are going to lead us. And we're speaking to the heaviness that, yes, God, your burden is light, your yoke is easy, and we trust in you. And so today, I want to invite you to take communion. We're going to take it together, Melanie and I. And I want to invite you, in the spirit of that, just to simply take it in the next few moments with your family, with your friends, or by yourself if you're by yourself, and to simply declare, God, I trust you. And in this moment, I pour out my love on you because of everything that you did for me. So would you take this in remembrance of Him?
Dear 2020.
We need to talk. I'm not sure how to say this, but this isn't working.
I'm tired. I'm afraid. I've let you in and you've cost me everything.
My dreams, my peace of mind, my sanity. And you're not changing.
So I am. I'm moving on.
The cost is just too high. So I guess this is goodbye.
I've got a life to live.
And I'm gonna live it.
And I'm gonna live it.
I'm gonna live it.
I want to start with a question, and here it is. What is keeping you from your best life? Now, I know it's a deep question, but it's really the end of this series that we've been in where Jesus invites us to the best life when he says, "Come follow me and I will make you fishers of men." But what I've learned is that for many of us, we always have an excuse why we can't be our best self or the best version of ourselves. And I think this whole series, Goodbye 2020, is kind of our tongue-in-cheek way of saying, hey, it's time for you to say goodbye to the past, shed it, and experience something new. And what I'm learning in this whole lockdown scenario is that maybe there are some things that we should not go back to. And so many see this as a limitation. I see it as an opportunity. And so I got asking myself this question, why don't people live their best life? Like, I think we all want to, but why don't we? And I came up with three plausible explanations. The first one is we just don't know there's a better life. We just don't know it. Now, again, there's no judgment in this church at all, but here's just an observation, okay? I have a bit of British history in my background, and so there is a proper way to drink tea. Now, I'm not, you know, if you microwave your water and throw in a tea bag, well, okay, that's good, I guess. But maybe you boil your water and you put your tea bag in then. Okay, that's better, but there is a way to experience tea at its best. And it means you gotta start with raw leaves. You gotta know if it's a black tea or a white tea or a green tea, if you should boil the water, for how long you should steep it. You know, of course, that you got to put the milk in first so you don't crack your porcelain dish. You know these things, right? There's a proper way. And if you've ever had tea, like high tea in a real place, it's amazing. You never want to go back. And so maybe you just didn't know that. That's okay. No judgment. Just letting you know that's how you drink tea. But I think it works in the spiritual realm too. I think about generosity. I have just learned that if you are generous, it always comes back to you. But maybe you didn't know that. Maybe the reason you're not generous is because you didn't know that. That's okay. So there's a reason why we don't always live our best. Sometimes we just don't know there's a better. Sometimes we know the better, but we're not really sure it's going to work. Let me give you an example in my own life. I right now am trying intermittent fasting for health reasons. And I'm sleeping a little bit better, and yeah, it looks like it's working, but I'm not sure, so sometimes I cheat just a little bit because I'm not sure it's really going to work. And in the spiritual realm, I guess you could say, a lot of people approach prayer that way. They're not really sure it's going to work, and so they don't do it. But there's a third reason, and this is the one I really want to kind of focus on here today. Sometimes you don't know, and that's true. But sometimes you do know and you're not sure it works. But what about when you do know and you know it works and you just don't want to do it? That is the conundrum. And I think that is, to be honest with you, where most of us live. Like, think about it this way, exercise. We all know that if we exercise, we're going to be healthier, we're going to live longer, our mental state is going to be better, but we just don't want to do it. I guess in the spiritual realm, we could use forgiveness in this context. We know we should forgive, but we just don't want to. And so in the story that we've been exploring over these past 5 weeks, we've been looking at the story of Jesus. And in this story, Jesus challenges all three reasons why you can't be your best, and he calls you to be your best. And so if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. And this is the last week we're going to be reading this story, but I hope you've gained a lot of insight as we've been unpacking this together. So in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18, it says, "As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen." So the first thing we see in the story is that they didn't know there was a better. It says they were fishermen. And that's not a slam on them. It's just the reality. That's all they knew. They didn't know there was a better life than this. And so they were doing their very best in it. And so into their limitation, their thinking, Jesus says, "Come, follow me." He invites them to be actually who they were created to be. And he sets the target for them. He says, "Come, follow me." And we learned that that means to love at all costs. And so maybe you're here and you're not living your best life. Can I just offer you a solution found in the words of Jesus? The first one is just simply to know the Jesus way. What he says is, "Come, follow me." Now, I don't know if you've ever had this experience, especially with technology. You purchase a device, whatever it is, and you decide, you know what, I'm just going to figure it out. I'm not going to read the owner's manual. And so there's all kinds of features that you just have never explored or you didn't even know were possible. Like the other day, I found out on my iPhone, if I hold the screen down, the space bar, I can actually move the cursor on my texting. It's amazing, but I didn't know that. But an operator's manual is not a negotiation. It's like, no, this is the way this was designed to work. And it's the same with your life. When Jesus comes into our existence, he's not negotiating with us. He's saying, no, this is the way you should live. It's the way you were designed to live. And there are features in your life you don't even know exist yet. But if you'll let me, I will show those to you so you can live your very best life. That's why Jesus came into this world. And so there are lots of ways that you can know this. You can study the Bible, God's word. You can pray. You can meditate. There are many ways. But here's the deal. If you don't know, don't be satisfied with not knowing. Do whatever it takes to discover God's best for your life. And so I love it the way it says in 1 John 2:5. It says, "But if anyone obeys the words of Jesus, the love for God is truly made complete in them." Here's what it means. If you make a decision to follow Jesus, God's love is fully revealed. It begins the process of you being exactly who you were created to be, your very best version of you. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. And so maybe you're here and you say, like, I don't know. Maybe you're new to this whole thing. I want you to know that Jesus invites you to live the best version of yourself by following him. Why? Because he's the perfect example of what we can be when we choose love. So then, okay, maybe we can discover Jesus. And maybe that's the whole point of him coming into this world and teaching us. But what about when you're not sure it really is true? You know it, you've heard it. Maybe you grew up in Sunday school. Maybe you go to church all the time, but you're not sure that this is really, it really is going to work for you. For you, a lot of Christianity sounds kind of like pie in the sky, naive optimism, right? So how do you know? Well, in this story, Jesus says, "Come follow me and I will make you fishers of men." And Pastor Justin, again, did a great job in week 3 unpacking this idea that it's about becoming. It's a process. I think a lot of us give up way too quickly on things that really matter. Because here's what I've learned. The things that really matter are hard work and take a lot of time. The more difficult something is, honestly, the more beautiful it often is. I think a lot of us approach life like this. Imagine you take a seed and you're just walking randomly and you just throw it onto some hard ground and you come by the next day and you're really disappointed that it hasn't grown into a full harvest, a field full of wheat or a flower bed full of flowers, and you're so frustrated. Well, but that's not the way it works, right? There's a process. You understand that. And so you gotta test it. You gotta try it. And so when Jesus says, "Come follow me, I will make you," he's talking about a process, that it is a journey of sometimes, yes, trial and error. And in that, you learn to trust him. I mean, listen, think about it this way. Your best friend. How do you know they're your best friend? Because you've been through the fire with them, right? They were there for you when everyone else left you. They're your best friend because they know the good and the bad and really the ugly, and they still love you. It's through that experience and that process that you become friends. And this is the reality with Jesus as well. So okay, maybe you're here and you say, like, I don't really know if there's better for me. Well, I want to tell you, you can. The solution is get to know Jesus, because he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and I will show you how you can live your best version of yourself. The second thing, though, is that you got to try. You got to step out. You got to trust. You can't just believe the Jesus way. You got to live the Jesus way. Here's what it says in Psalm 34, verse 8. It says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, which just means, it's an old English way of saying, trust the Lord or trust God, trust Jesus, you his holy people, for those who fear him lack nothing. And he uses this really interesting analogy, taste and see. Now, again, how do you know if something tastes good? Now, I'm not talking about all of you people out there who are finicky and you already precondition your brain for failure. You just think, oh, it's never going to taste good, and you ever try it. And when you do try it, you've already told yourself it's awful, so it is. I'm talking about, no, how do you really know? How do you explore? I've traveled all over the world, and I've tasted all kinds of amazing things. And the first step is you got to put it in your mouth. You got to taste it and see if it really is good. Now, here's the problem. A lot of us have just preconditioned ourselves for failure, but God has actually built inside of you the opportunity to be the best version of yourself when you do it his way. But you got to do it his way. Like Nike says, you just got to do it. Just do it. Okay, so that's the solution to the first two challenges. But what about the final one? What about when you know what's right, okay? And I think most of us kind of do. And you actually believe, okay, if I did the right thing, it would turn out well. I just stop for a second here and think about that. You kind of know what you should be doing in your relationship right now. You kind of know what you should be doing with your own time. You kind of know, like, I think most of us know, but I think the real challenge comes when we just don't want to do it. And there's lots of reasons we don't want to do it. Sometimes it's pride. Sometimes it's greed. Sometimes it's fear. Sometimes it's insecurity. So what do you do then? Well, this is exactly where Peter and Andrew are. Jesus says, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Now here's the point, and this will be the turning point. Honestly, right now, what I'm about to tell you will literally change your life forever if you understand it. Here it is. You and I have a choice to make. It's that simple. You and I are making choices every day, and the quality of those choices and the decisions made impact everything, not only us, but everything around us. And so Jesus steps into your existence and my existence, and he says, come follow me, and I will make you something. I will explore with you, and I will show you how you can be the best version of yourself. And now it's on you to make the choice. Are you going to do it or not? And so this story ends in verse 20, where it says, at once they left their nets and they followed him. Without that sentence, this story doesn't even make it in the Bible. Without that sentence, you probably never ever hear of Peter and Andrew. Without that sentence, they probably live the rest of their life, maybe content to be fishermen, but they miss the opportunity to be the very best version of themselves. It's in that sentence that you and I get to decide whether we're going to live in our full potential or in something else. And so, the solution, finally, in all of this, this wraps everything we've talked about in these 5 weeks, is courage. It says they left their nets and followed him. I got thinking about that because it says immediately they left their nets. I mean, they had no guarantees. They weren't sure how this was all going to work out, but they immediately left their nets. They were so challenged by the possibility of this invitation that they said, yes, right now. I got thinking about nets, and I may be stretching this analogy a bit, but it really worked for me. You know what nets are? Nets are our excuses. They're the things that tangle us up, hold us down, keep us back. There's something that happened to us in the past that we can't let go of. There's some limitation in our current situation. We think, I can never be anything better than I am. And there are a fear of the future that, no, it's never going to be better. And so they let these nets go, and so do you. You need to let the excuses go. Whatever excuse you're making, even right now as you're listening to me, I know how it's working in your mind. Well, he doesn't know this, or but. You know, we got to say goodbye to our buts, and we got to say goodbye to our excuses, and we got to step into really what God has for us. I love what Benjamin Franklin said. He said, "He that is good for making excuses is seldom good for anything else." That hurts, but it's true. And so my question is, what do you need to let go of right now? If you've been challenged in this series and you're like, man, yeah, I want that. Okay. Then what do you need to let go of in order to pursue it? Maybe it's a thought. Maybe it's a habit. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's an attitude. Maybe it's something that you have held on to your whole life and it's your security blanket. You don't want to let go. Because I know you. I know you know what you should do. The question is, are you going to do it? So they dropped their nets and they followed him. You see, you have to walk into it. I finish with one thought. It's interesting that Jesus called him to be fisher of men. And I was thinking about that. I was thinking about a fisherman. I'm not a fisherman, but I have people in my family who are. And what they've taught me about fishing is that it requires a lot of patience. It's a commitment. I mean, you're going to sit sometimes in very cold environment, in silence for a very long period of time. But you're going to have to learn how to do this because it is a skill. It's not something you just pick up. It's not like you just go to Canadian Tire, buy a little kid's rod, throw it and catch a fish. Well, sometimes you get lucky, but not often. It takes skill. It takes perseverance. It takes determination. It takes focus. It takes a bit of mentoring, a bit of coaching, a bit of understanding, but you got to do it. You got to get in the boat and you got to go to where the fish are. And that's how you become a true fisherman. And so as we wrap up this series, my question to you really is, do you really want to be a follower of Jesus? Now you may make the choice not to, and that's your choice. That's the power of love. It allows you to choose, but make sure you understand the consequences of that choice. But if you have made that choice, then it's time for us to stop making the excuses. You say, well, I don't know. Well, then find out. Well, I don't know if it's going to work. Well, then try. Keep trying. Or maybe I don't want to. Maybe it's time for you to let go of the excuses, let go of the things that are holding you back, and make the decision to follow him, to do it his way. For his way is the only way to experience the best version of you. And so with that, I bless you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Why don't you take a few moments, even right now, to engage with the discussion questions on your screen with whoever is in the room with you. Also, you can take the next step by joining us again online next week. You can join one of the amazing groups that we have to offer you, or you can join us for prayer this Tuesday from 6 to 7 a.m. Lastly, if you're joining us live today, we actually have a virtual Connect event. So if you're new to Central, or if you've been around for the last year or so, maybe even haven't been able to join us in person yet, we would love it if you signed up for that and got to know some others. As always, if you have any questions at all, come to our website, centralcc.ca/connect, or text the word central to 905-937-5610. With that, I hope you have an amazing week this week, and hope you'll join us again next week.